Hachette Audio presents The 1998 Yankees, the inside story of the greatest baseball team ever. Written and read by Jack Curry. For my dad, Jack, I hope I have half of your curiosity, your wit, and your street smarts. I know you would have placed this book beside your Jack's writing scrapbook. Proud to be your namesake. For my father-in-law, Jack Orbine, I'm in awe of your vitality, your strength, and your positive attitude. We're forever bonded by your devotion to family and your knowledge of the nuances of baseball. Introduction. We were talking about the 1998 Yankees, and my question to Derek Jeter was as obvious and as predictable as a question could be. When Jeter reflects upon the 1998 team, that immensely powerful and wonderfully cohesive team, what is the first thing that leaps into his brain? Greatest team ever, Jeter said. That's what comes to mind. For someone who spent a 20-year career in New York being intentionally bland and not bragging about himself or his teams, Jeter's words were noteworthy and blunt. There were numerous ways Jeter could have praised the 1998 Yankees before instantly describing them as better than any team in baseball history. He could have gushed about a relentless lineup that drained and destroyed pitchers. He could have raved about a bullish starting rotation that basically featured an ace a day. He could have complimented a balanced bullpen that was anchored by the brilliant Mariano Rivera. Or Jeter could have talked about the unprecedented 125 wins and a season of dominance. But Jeter started at the top. He gave the headline before he discussed the details of the story. Hey, look, it's so difficult, Jeter said. You can't compare eras. It's impossible to do that. The game has changed so much. Look how the game has changed since I retired, and that's a short period of time. It's very difficult to compare eras. Still, even after Jeter hedged a bit in describing how difficult it is to compare teams from different eras, he returned to his original statement, greatest team ever. So for selfish reasons, I say it's the greatest team, Jeter said. I would put it up there against any team in history, and I would like our chances. As usual, Jeter is right. The 1998 Yankees were a very talented, very focused, and very successful team. A club that exemplified what a team should be. They didn't have superstars or even all-stars at every position, but they had an amazing nucleus, a talented supporting cast, and a steely-eyed focus. Watching the Yankees perform was like watching a group of pinstriped gentlemen who bullied the opposition, but who also dominated with dignity. Of course, Jeter was the burgeoning star, the cool and handsome shortstop, who actually dated pop star Mariah Carey that year and who did everything adeptly on the field. The kid wearing number 2 was beloved, especially by the kids who squealed over every move he made. Second baseman Chuck Knoblauch was a pest of a leadoff hitter whose postseason brain cramp created the most stressful moments of the year. But he and the Yankees survived and thrived. On a passionate and focused team, the most intense player was right fielder Paul O'Neill, who treated every at-bat like it was his last and who treated water coolers like they were punching bags. Much more relaxed than O'Neill was Bernie Williams, a switch-hitting center fielder who was committed to ending 1998 much differently than he ended 1997. Like O'Neill, Tino Martinez was another intense left-handed hitter who vanquished some postseason struggles with a memorable grand slam in the World Series. The catching position was shared by the fiery Jorge Posada and the intelligent Joe Girardi, two dedicated men behind the plate. From the unlikely hero department, minor league lifer Shane Spencer swooped into the Bronx, invaded a potent lineup, and delivered a bunch of prodigious September swings. Scott Brosius was the biggest surprise of the season, a third baseman who rocketed from a 2-0-3 hitter in Oakland to a World Series MVP in New York. At various times, the bench included future Hall of Famer Tim Raines, Darryl Strawberry, and Chili Davis. In their careers, the trio combined for 6,386 hits, 855 homers, and 1,171 stolen bases. That's an iconic bench. On the pitching staff, David Wells found a way to be perfect for one day and perfectly agitating to manager Joe Torre on some other days. David Cone, the ultimate New York baseball player, treated Wells like a brother while also forming a dynamic 1-2 combo with him. Andy Pettit was a ferocious competitor who won the clinching game of the World Series, even in a season where he grappled with some health issues in his family. Orlando El Duque Hernandez, the gift of a pitcher from Cuba, brought grit and style to a juggernaut and also had youngsters in the New York area lifting their knees to their chins as they pitched. With Rivera in the bullpen, Jeter often said, "When we go to Moe, we know the game is over." In that season, and in so many other seasons, it was. The Yankees lost only one game when they held the lead after 8 innings. The stoic Rivera emphatically erased the disappointment of allowing a crushing homer in the 1997 postseason. And guiding all the players was Torre, the man who Jeter called the perfect manager for this team. After a sluggish start in the first week led to some dubious questions about Torre's job security, he chastised the Yankees during a memorable team meeting in Seattle. The Yankees responded like a bulldozer rolling over an aluminum can, causing Torre to say he had never managed a team that simply refused to lose even one game. 25 years after that historic season, I revisited it with the players who churned through a season like none they had ever experienced. These interviews provide new perspectives and new insights about that spectacular season, from how they bonded quickly, to how they squabbled, not too often, to how they soared, often. Over and over, the players marveled at what they had accomplished. Time, it was clear, had made them even prouder. "It's the greatest team ever," said Wells. "There's no doubt. Just look at the depth we had." O'Neill added, "It was as close to a perfect team as I've ever been around." Finally, Torre said, "I think I managed the best team of all time." I co-authored a book called The Life You Imagine with Jeter while he was still playing, and there were topics he simply didn't want to discuss. In contrast, he was thrilled to discuss the historical placing of the 1998 Yankees. After noting how the Yankees didn't have a player who hit even 30 homers that year, Jeter returned to the theme of how deep, versatile, and deadly they were. He stressed how the Yankees could beat you in so many different ways and how they could still excel when a few players were struggling. So when I say I would put us up there against any team, what I mean is that every team goes through times where they scuffle, Jeter added. But if we had 2 or 3 guys who were struggling, somebody else would always step up. And then Jeter said something I'll never forget. "We," Jeter said, "wanted to pummel teams." Pummel teams, not just beat them, but pummel them. And they did. As Jeter explained, somebody would always produce for the Yankees, all the way to a 125-50 record, which is engraved on the left shank of their World Series championship rings, and all the way to asserting themselves as the greatest team of all time. Jeter knows. "I still don't think anyone's going to do what we did," Jeter said. "Not 125-50. I don't think it will be done again." Chapter 1. Before Glory, Suffering. The baseball gods were taunting the Yankees, stalking them and scaring them. On a crisp October night in Cleveland, they mocked the defending champions, telling them their season was almost over. The Yankees had one lonely out left. One more chance. Just one more chance to save themselves. That's what the Yankees were hoping to do against the Indians. And after Paul O'Neill's scorching line drive off the right field fence and his sprawling dive into second base for a double, the Yankees had that chance. They were still hopeful of winning the 1997 division series, and Bernie Williams was the player who carried that snippet of a hope to the plate. Always thoughtful, always patient, and much more tenacious than he looked, Williams had seemed unsettled while managing 2 hits and 16 at-bats in the series. But Williams, who was armed with a 32-ounce bat, had the chance to redeem himself.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.